गुड मॉर्निंग टू एक्सटर्नल एक्सपर्ट्स, रेस्पेक्टेड डीन सर, नीता मैम, राजेश मिश्रा सर एंड ऑल फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट हु आर प्रेजेंट हियर। टुडे माय पब्लिक डिफेंस प्रेजेंटेशन ऑन परफॉर्मेंस एनहांसमेंट इन कम्युनिकेशन बेस्ड हाई स्पीड ट्रेन कंट्रोल सिस्टम एंड आई एम भूपेंद्र सिंह एंड आई डिड माई वर्क अंडर द सुपरविजन ऑफ डॉक्टर राजेश मिश्रा। And here is the outline of the presentation. First is the CBTC concept, standards and architecture, literature survey, problem identification, objective of research, research methodology, packet drop during handover in CBTC. The main work starts from here, and MAC protocol in CBTC in DCF, both mechanism, and conclusion and references. First, the introduction about the small introduction about the CBTC system. According to the IEEE standard 1474.1, the primary characteristics of CBTCs are high resolution train location determination mechanism independent of track circuit. While in the conventional fixed block signaling, there is dependency on the track circuit and continuous high capacity bidirectional train to wayside data communication system. Train born and wayside processor performing the necessary functions. This is the small unit of you can say a small introduction pictorial form of CBTC system. There is a train born unit where there is ATP, ATO, ATS, and through communication link it is connected to the access point, and that access point connected to the wayside unit, which is usually called the zone controller. And by this, the location of the train is transmitted via the communication media, and radio has become a technology of choice for the among supplier. Means it uses a radio communication. It's not enough to determine the location of the train; it must be also safe. So there are CBTC building blocks who make possible communication under the CBTC. First is the ATP function. Under ATP function, there is two functions are positioning functioning and travel direction routing and interlocking function. Position function, it has the ability of the CBTC system to track and keep train safety separated from each other. And travel direction routing and interlocking function, it ensure when routing the train, the path is dedicated to that particular train. And ATO function, it does the speed determination and regular monitoring, and the ability it has the ability of the CBTC system to determine, monitor and control the speed of that particular train. And it also performs the miscellaneous function like work zone, door control, interlocks, broken rail detection and grade crossing. Another is the function of ATS that has the user interface, train tracking, routing, automatic train regulation, stop station stop function, restricting train operations, passenger information and announcements, and fault reporting. That is the function of ATS functions over the train. There are three signaling scheme. Two are the conventional signaling, that is conventional fixed block signaling and cap signaling, and last is moving block CBTC signaling. So conventional fixed block signaling is in this, the driver use the track side signals, means red, yellow and green signals it use. If the train can proceed forward, it is speed up the train at which that particular train is travel at. And the simple system, it has three signals, red, yellow and green. And we all know that red for yellow stop and yellow for proceed with the caution and green for move at maximum speed. The location of the train is determined by the track circuit occupancy. So this is the basic structure of basic conventional fixed block signaling. So the signal engineer views the track in the small chunks, means there are the chunks 1, 2, 3, 4, and the block length determines the safety and capacity. So the block length, the safety means how far apart the train will keep from each other, and the capacity, how many trains can pass through that particular system, that tells the capacity. So in that particular system, fixed block signaling system, there was the challenge for the signal engineer is increase the block length. If a signal engineer increase the particular block length for the safety, it increase the margin but safety for safety, but it reduces the capacity of the trains. Means number of trains passing through the system will be less. Means service availability will be less. And if it reduce the block length, means increase the capacity but reduce the margin of safety. Means if the block length is reduced, then it increases the capacity. Means number of trains which is for the serving that may increase, but there can be the breach in the safety. So it is a basic concept. It is a pictorial form. Train 8 and train 9, and one block separation must be there. And the receding train can get a passing signal only when the train is in the train passes through the next block. So this is about the conventional fixed block signaling. What about the capacity? If the train 8 hits the trip, stop traveling at 60 km/h, so that block means the safety distance can be determined by the according to the speed of that particular train, which is proceeding train and receding train also. If the train 8 hits the trip, stop traveling at 60 km/h, and it requires 400 m to stop, so the block separation between two trains will be 400 m for the safety requirement. And train 9 travels away from signal C, train 8 will not be granted the permissive, but it can get the permissive. It cannot granted the permission to move at the fullest speed, but it can get the permission to move at the slowest speed. So instead of artificial separation is created between train 8 and train 9, and that is basically is still maintained for a safe braking distance. So this is also, so this at the block 3, this space basically wasted in the fixed block signaling scheme, because for the safety reasons, when the train 9 exited the block 3, then only train 8 will get the permission to move on. So once train 9 exits block 3, then it will receive the permissive expect for the signal B. So there may be exactly the block length is 400 m for the safety, but the train may for the safety distance, it may take the 800 m separation for between two trains, which is very longer, and it affects the basically capacity of the track. So for the different train speeds, the block length will be different. So and the braking curve, it needs to apply the braking curve much behind, as this is the example. For 40 km/h, the braking curve will be less, and the for 60 km/h, the braking curve will be high. So that block will be fixed for the conventional fixed block signaling for the all speed criterias. Next is the cap signaling. That is the enhancement in the fixed block signaling. It uses the track side signal. It don't use the track side signal, and track circuit are used to determine the location of the train only, and the speed and distance to go are displayed on the train overview display. Means the speed at which the train must be go on, that will be displayed on the TOD, that is the train overview display, inside the cab. And cab signaling has the capability to allow the train to move at multiple speeds. So the signal which is coming from the forwarding train will decide at how much speed the receding train must be move on. So the cab signaling does not alter the fixed lock or conventional signaling concept. So this is the pictorial profile of that. Means according to the speed at which the train 9 is moving, so according to that train 8 will get the permission to move on different profile or different speeds, like 80 km/h, 60 km/h, and 40 km/h. So it is the advanced, we can say it is the advanced fixed block signaling scheme. The summary of these two is cap signaling allows the smaller blocks and therefore a marginal increase in capacity, but the problem are similar to the conventional signaling, like increase the block size, increase the margin of safety, but reduces capacity. Reducing the block size decreases the margin of safety, but increase capacity. Challenge of signal engineer is to calculate the block length, and the track is not utilized at its fullest. To overcome these two signaling scheme, the CBTC came into the picture, and it is also called the moving block signaling scheme. It uses the track side signal, means track signal is not used, track circuit is not used, and position is determined by the bi-directional communication between the wayside and train equipments. And the train transmits its position to the wayside equipment, and wayside transmits a target point, means the location of the forwarding train or the speed profile and the distance of the forwarding train. And the train is able to determine its position with the resolution measures in centimeter. So this is the comparison between conventional and cap signaling and CBTC signaling. So there is a block which is defined by the signal engineer, and there is no block in the moving block signaling scheme, and because of that the capacity and safety is more in CBTC, or you can say the moving block signaling scheme. The basic operation is if the train 8 is traveling at 60 km per hour, it must maintain 400 meter for separation from train 9. This separation is not enforced by physical track circuit block, but the dynamic calculation by train 8, means calculation has been made by the ATO function in the train 8, that at which speed the train 8 must be gone. So as the train 9 move forward, train 8 follow while maintaining the safety distance. There is no artificial separation between trains, only the bare minimum separation required to maintain the safety distances. And the safety distance is reduced in this moving block signaling scheme. So this is the comparison between the braking curve of conventional and cap signaling and CBTC signaling scheme. There are three standard of CBTC standard which has been made by IEEE, that is IEEE 1474.1, under which CBTC performance and functional requirement in terms of configuration, type of railroad and expected functions comes, and IEEE 1474.2, under which the consistent user interface requirement for enhanced service effectiveness of CBTC system comes, and IEEE 1474.3, recommended practice for CBTC system design and functional allocation. Here are some of CBTC application which comprises Delhi Metro Rail Corporation, Magenta Line, Kuala Lumpur, Kalana J Line, Hyderabad Metro, Sydney Metro, Mumbai Metro Rail Corporation, Kolkata Metro Rail Corporation, etc. So the summary of introduction is the separation between train is kept to the bare minimum required to maintain the safety distance between trains. And safety distance is no longer a static entity enforced by the fixed block, but a adjustable distance based on a real-time calculation of the train speed. And CBTC signaling extract the maximum capacity as per the track design, and the capacity is affected by the separation between the trains, and each signaling system has its own characteristics that affects the train separation. This is the literature survey by which the problem has been identified. So, these some slide as the literature survey. So, according to this literature survey, problem has been identified that for enhancing the true performance of CBTC system, the work should be done on communication interruption and long latency. Weak wireless signal in the handoff zone and fast handoff in high speed trains may lead the communication interruption and affect the safety operation of the train. So according to the problem identification, I set the objective of research. The first objective was to reduce the impact of handoff latency by introducing the soft handoff on the regulated presentation of CBTC system. to improve the overall performance of the existing CBTC system for high-speed trains and to propose a novel method for security and safety scheduling of the trains. So the research methodology which has been adopted to achieving the all the objective, for the first objective, the methodology is based on exploration of the randomized data packet loss in CBTC networks at the time of handover. And the second objective is achieved by analyzing the random packet drop and handover time for the different train speed till 200 km per hour. To achieve the third objective, we have used four-way handshake mechanism. Four-way handshake, request to send and clear to send delay model is used to develop the CBTC system. And four-way handshake is applied in CBTC to overcome the packet delay and throughput limitation of the two-way handshake method of distributed coordination function. So the first objective is packet drop during handover in CBTC. So packet drop depends on several factors. First is handover time, and it is further depending on probing, authentication, association, coverage area of a particular AP, and intersecting coverage zone. So there are defined two APs, and this is the coverage area of first AP, and this is the coverage area of second AP, and this is intersecting coverage zone, which is between A and C. So the running time of the train at speed Vm will be defined as TR is equals to DAP dot N into N minus DOV to N minus 1 upon Vm. So it is basically the time distance formula, where DAP is denotes the coverage range of an access point, and N is the total number of APs, DOV is the length of intersecting coverage zone, and Vm is the maximum train speed. So the intersecting coverage zone length must satisfy the this DOV is DAB and DBC, means this AB and BC will make DOV, and DAB is equals to DBC, that must be equal, DAB and DBC will be equal, and DAB is the distance between A and B, DBC is the distance between point B and C, and TM is the longest handover time. And due to handover, the rate of packet drop is given by this PHO is limit n tends to infinite n minus 1 NHO by NTO, where NHO is the number of drop packet in each handover, and NTO is the number of transmitted packet, total number of transmitted packets. So major contribution of this work is result of packet drop of existing scheme are compared against proposed simulation result, and simulation result are showing improved drop rate over existing scheme. Effect of changing packet duration on number of drop packet in each handover and on total number of transmitted packet is analyzed. Analyze the effect of changing train speed over packet drop. Analyze the effect of number of access point on packet drop, and also analyze the effect of changing handover time on packet drop. So this is the table which has been made by this comparison of packet drop rate between the existing result and simulation results. So table has been made for this test duration. I have taken multiple test duration, total number of drop packets are these, total number of transmitted packets are these, drop rate which has been occurred is this in the existing work, 0.003133 and 0.004929. I am taking the test duration 2748 and 4749 seconds. So the drop rate in that is existing scheme is 0.003133 and 0.004929, but in the proposed result it is 0.002969 and 0.003699, which is much lesser than the existing scheme. And the system behavior between means for maximum handover time and the maximum handover time and the speed is for the different test duration is, for test duration 2748 it is 76.262 and the test duration 4749 it is 164.187 for the speed of 60 km per hour. These result has been extracted from these graphs. So first one is a comparison of packet drop rate between proposed and existing, and second one is the effect of changing packet duration T on total number of transmitted packets, as the packet duration increases, so the total number of transmitted packet decreases, and effect of changing packet duration on the drop packet in each handover means if we are increasing the packet duration, the packet drop R each handover are decreasing, and effect of changing handover time on packet duration or packet drop rate, it is means when the handover time is increasing, the packet drop rate is increasing. If we are changing the train speed, means for the multiple train speeds, the packet drop rate is increasing. So this is the table for checking the packet drop rate on the multiple speed profiles. For the speed of 30, the packet drop rate is 0.01, while in the proposed scheme it is 0.0076, and for 60 km per hour it is 0.027 for existing and 0.0154 for proposed, and for 200 km per hour it is 0.1 for existing and 0.0552 is for proposed scheme in the simulation. So it is the when we are increasing the number of APs, the packet drop rate is increasing. So the sum.
How did you calculate this drop rate,
sir?
Drop rate कैसे calculate किया आपने?
The drop rate has been calculated by the formula this one. PHO is limit n tends to infinite n minus 1 NHO upon NTO.
एजेप्शंस क्या रहे आपके?
Yes sir.
क्या एजेप्शंस रहे आपके? सिमुलेशन में किया ना आपने?
Yes sir.
क्या एजेप्शंस थे?
सर फील्ड रिजल्ट्स के साथ कंपैरिजन किया है सर.
फील्ड रिजल्ट में क्या रिजल्ट आया था? क्या कांस्टेंट था पैरामीटर?
सर दीज आर द कांस्टेंट नंबर ऑफ ड्रॉप पैकेट इन ईच हैंडओवर एंड द नंबर ऑफ टोटल नंबर ऑफ ट्रांसमिटेड पैकेट इन ईच हैंडओवर.
तो इनको कहाँ से निकाला, कैसे निकाले आपने?
सर हैंडओवर द हैंड ऑफ व्हेन एवर द हैंड ऑफ अकर्स इट मूव्स व्हेन इट मूव्स द ट्रेन मूव्स आउट द रेंज ऑफ ए पर्टिकुलर एक्सेस पॉइंट इट ट्राइज टू कनेक्ट सो व्हेन एवर द हैंड ओवर अकर्स द पैकेट ड्रॉप्स सो बाय दिस फॉर्मूला वी हैव put some assumptions and put some values in that in this rate of packet drop, and we have taken the results over the changing you can say over the changing effect of changing it over time on the packet drop rate means different means we are analyzing the effect of changing handover time on the packet drop rate, also effect of changing packet duration on the packet drop rate. So all the parameters we are assuming, taking all the parameters and taking the effect of analyzing the effect of all the parameters on the handover packet drop rate in each handover. Sir,
continue recording.
Summary is we study packet drop during handover, and the analytical result obtained on the rate of packet drop during handover are found to be consistent with the existing work. The communication and train control issues the impact of random packet drop on the stability and performances on the CBTC system have been analyzed. And the simulation results are shows that the rate of packet drop during handover are found to be consistent and more appropriate than the existing work under three velocity condition 30, 60, and 200. So these are two conference. Scopus index paper has been published in under in this on this work. Next is the MAC protocol in CBTC, distributed coordination function. The WLAN IEEE 802.11 is standard for wireless network, includes two basic access techniques, distributed coordination function and point coordination function. Out of these, distributed coordination function has been utilized for the CBTC because DCF is the member of family of CSMA/CA based medium, means carrier sense multiple access collision, and it is a basic medium of 802.11. So the DCF has two schemes, the two-way handshake mechanism and four-way handshake mechanism, RTS and CTS, request to send and clear to send. So for DCF, two-way handshake, and for CBTC is the data success rate of data is defined by this. Packet one is if the packet one is transmitted at a particular time, so it waits for short inter-frame gap for the acknowledgement. When acknowledgement comes, it uses the DIF, means distributed inter-frame gap and back-off time for the sending of the another packets. And likewise, when the data sending successfully, this profile is used. And the for failed data, when packet one is transmitted, it uses the acknowledgement. It waits for the time that is acknowledgement timeout. After the acknowledgement timeout, it waits for the distributed interframe gap for making that channel ideal for the transmission. And after back off time, the packet one again transmitted. Then again, this time is taken for the acknowledgement. Then again, packet transmitted. If till then the packet is successful, that is in the DCF two-way handshake mechanism. And the DCF four-way handshake mechanism, RTS, CTS uses first the request to send is sent to the destination. After the short interframe gap, the clear to send comes. If the clear to send comes, then data will be transmitted and uses. And when the acknowledgement is come, then after DIFG, the next request, or you can say net data, next data will be transmitted. So network vector allocation vector is virtual carrier sensing mechanism. After sending RTS, in network vector allocation, RTS is initialized so that the no other station attempts to transmit after the SI short interference gap to issue the clear to send. So these are the major contribution of this work. Effect of increasing number of retransmission of packet delay during trackside communication using RTS-CTS delay model of DCF has been simulated and analyzes the change in packet delay over various data rates as compared to TWH mechanism of 802.11 DCF. Analyze the trend of average packet delay for 802.11b with changing data rates for both the mechanism. And maximum throughput is simulated for the both the mechanism, and effect of increasing minimum contention window on saturation throughput, effect of increasing minimum contention window on average delay, effect of increasing minimum contention window on effect of increasing slot transmission probability on saturation throughput, and effect of increasing slot transmission probability on average delay, effect of increasing number of station on average delay has been analyzed for different contenting stations for both the schemes. So this is the packet delay comparison analysis for TWH and RTS, RTS-CTS of FWH mechanism. So for TWH mechanism, this is the delay profile time, delay time which has been taken for the failure data, that is this delay one is used for DCS mechanism. So T data plus T acknowledgement timeout plus DIFG, D backoff, D data, then again till then that particular packet will be transferred. So these results has been taken out for the different data speeds for the different data rates, that is 1 Mbps, 2 Mbps, 5.5 Mbps, and 11 Mbps between the retransmission and packet delay. means number of retransmission occurred and the packet delay. When one retransmission occurred, so for the different speed data rates, that is 1 Mbps, 2 Mbps, 5.5 and 11. This is for the RTS ETS mechanism. The number of retransmission and packet delay for different data rates. So for RTS ETS mechanism, T delay 2N is 2 means for 2 is used for RTS ETS mechanism, TRTS, TSIFS, TCTS, that is used. And this is between the data rate versus average packet delay. With the maximum transmission time R, the average 802.11p packet transmission delay 2p is expressed as this formula. And these results are extracted for both TWH mechanism and FWH RTS ETS mechanism. So by increasing the data rates, the average packet delay is decreasing. So this table has been made for 1 Mbps for the number of retransmission. For first retransmission, the packet delay for 1 Mbps. So it can be made for further data rates also. So it is for 1 Mbps, and that is 8.4 for TWH and 6.4 for 6.1 for RTS ETS mechanism. For fourth retransmission, this is 36.7 and 25.2 for RTS ETS. And the maximum throughput calculation comparison between the FAM structure of 802.11b. So this is the graph between data rate versus throughput. Whenever when the data rate increases, the throughput increases for the both the mechanism TWH and RTS ETS. This is the comparison between TWH mechanism and RTS ETS mechanism of throughput versus data rate. When data rate is 1 Mbps, then for the TWH mechanism throughput is 0.85, and for RTS ETS it is 0.72, and for 5.5 it is 3.06 and 2.13, and for 11 it is 4.29 and 2.72. So this these graphs are between the minimum contention window and throughput for the TWH and RTS ETS both. So this graph shows that by increasing the contention window, the throughput is increasing at some extent of time, then it gradually decreases for the both the cases. It is the graph between minimum contention window and average delay for both the mechanism. So this graph shows that minimum contention window increases, so the average delay decreases for some extent, then it increases gradually for all the number of contenting stations, means 2, 4, 8 and 10. So the maximum saturation throughput and minimum average delay table is for the both the mechanism is shown. Number of contenting stations are 2, 4, 8 and 10. So CW minimum for that is 31, 63, 127, 255. So the maximum saturation throughput for that is 0.8282, and minimum average delay is 0.0082 and 0.8058 for number of contenting station 4, and 0.7935 is for number of contenting station 8, and 0.7904 is for number of contenting station 10. And same as for RTS ETS mechanism. So these graphs are between the slot transmission poverty and throughput in TWH and RTS ETS. So this shows that when the slot transmission poverty increasing, the throughput is increasing. Throughput is increasing gradually. So this table has been made by the last graphs. So the maximum saturation throughput over various slot transmission probability has been shown in there. This is between slot transmission probability and average delay in both the mechanisms. So this is between the number of station versus average delay. So summary, the maximum packet delay almost reaches 90 milliseconds when transmission of the data packet occurs multiple times with the data rates at 1 Mbps. And this shows that communication cycle in CBTC must be more than 90 milliseconds. And our simulation results are exactly matching with the existing result. And DCF TWH mechanisms are used during train ground communication in CBTC. We further modified the existing delay model by including RTS-CTS mechanism. By comparing both results, we conclude that the RTS-CTS mechanism, the maximum packet delay almost reaches 70 milliseconds under similar conditions, which is much less than TWH access delay. This justifies that the RTS-CTS used to reduce the wastage of train time in event of collision. Rather than transmitting whole data, the frame-only RTS frame is retransmitted, which saves the time. So the maximum throughput is higher in TWH method as compared to RTS-CTS method due to extra overhead in RTS-CTS. So for the small number of contenting station, average delay is independent of slot transmission probability, but for larger value of contenting station, it increases rapidly with increase in slot transmission probability in both TWH and RTS-CTS mechanism. The maximum saturation throughput achieved during TWH is slightly higher than the RTS-CTS mechanism. These are one Scopus syntax. General paper is published in on this work, and one conference paper has been published in IEEE Explore. Next is analysis of operational reliability of railroad signaling scheme in Indian Railway. So the operation and the reliability except of railway signaling system for absolute block system and automatic block system has been explained under this. It also shows that the percentage of failure of different component of signaling system for a particular section of Indian Railway, and a comparative analysis on operational and reliability expect is provided. These are the comparison between different signaling scheme and their functional features. One is mechanical interlocking based signaling, second is electromechanical interlocking based signaling, third is panel route delay interlocking based signaling, and fourth is solid state interlocking based signaling. So under mechanical interlocking based signaling is interlocking frame. The blocks are interlocking frame, wire, rod, point, key lock point, slot system, mechanical detector, block instrument and signal. Under electromechanical, there is power supply, which is before the lever, then lever frame, lever lock system, electro locking, electrical locking is there, track, slot system, wire cable, rod, point with electric point, key lock point, block, signal, and signal reverser. And for panel and route delay interlock based signaling, power, panel, track, circuit. So the we can say the circuitry of that panel route delay interlocking based signaling is less than the electromechanical interlock based signaling, which comprises power, panel, track, circuit, cable, relay, point to point, back indication and signal. And for solid state, this is power supply, computer panel, track circuit, cable, or you can say cord, and point drive card, micro lock, point and point, back indication, signal driver card and signal. So as per the operational accept of signaling system, the operating person are involved to perform a number of operations such as setting the routes, setting the train speeds, maintaining time schedule and optimizing the line capacity. So for the safety and reliability of signaling system, it is required to improve the performance of the train movement under two principles. First is integration of different aspects, means under the huge traffic, different type of trains, advanced technology and dependent functions of railway system, and need for balance of underlying management policies have to be considered. So the reliability analysis, these parameter of reliability analysis are failure mode of each component of signaling scheme, shared use of same infrastructure by different railway services, different origin and destinations, different speeds, different halting patterns, arriving time of the trains, timetable scheduling, tracks setting, delay of train movement, and heterogeneity. There is a comparative analysis between all the signaling system, mechanical, electromagnetic, mechanical, root relay interlocking, solid state interlocking. The type of technology which is used in mechanical is mechanical controlled. In electromechanical, it is mechanical and electrical. Relay interlocking, it is relay controlled, and solid state has been controlled by computer. Technical expert in mechanical, at very low level, we need the technical experts, and for electromechanical, it is also for the low level, and for root relay, we need high level technical experts, and for solid state, very high level technical experts are required. Applicability is limited for mechanical, widely used for electromechanical, and widely used for root relay interlocking and solid state are very limited. Functional complexity, the mechanical is least complex and rest of three are complex. Number of repairable components in mechanical, almost all components are repairable. Electromechanical, very less components are repairable. Root relay interlocking, very less, and solid state interlocking, very less. Maintainability, very easy for mechanical, easy for electromechanical, and difficult for the root relay and solid state interlocking. The cost of operation is low for mechanical and high for the rest of three. So this is the reliability model of signaling. Basically, there are three type of signals, distant signal, interdistant signal, and ohm signal. Among of these signals, distant and interdistant signal act as a permissive signal, and ohm signal act as a stop signal, which stops the train and when required. So in the departure side, there are two signals, a starter signal and an advanced starter signal. The condition of expects and the corresponding indication of the different signal of approach and departure side, which are followed in the railways. So this is the automatic change of the sequence of the expects behind of the train as it passes. So these signals are used for the means when train and train is reaching at this point, first point. So whenever the signal is green, the forwarding signal is green, it moves on and it make the past signal red. So according to that, the train moves and the signal changes according to the movement of the train. So these tables are used for the indication of signal and approach in the multi-expect absolute block signaling, and indication for signal departure for multi-expect absolute block signaling. In signal approaching in the multi-expect absolute block signaling, the distant signal, interdistant signal, and home signal are used. So when the distant signal is yellow and this interdistant is yellow and home is red, that means stop and wait at a home. And when two signals are yellow and third is also yellow, then enter in loop line, stop at starter. So these are the signaling schemes for the absolute block signaling for approaching and for departure. That is for departure, starter and advanced starter signals are there. So when both the signals are red, so stand in the rear of starter. When one is yellow, one is red, shunt up in the advanced starter, and one is yellow or green or second is green, then proceed line is clear. That means proceed line is clear. So, and indication for signal in automatic block signaling, that is red, yellow, and double yellow and green. There are four signals are used. For red, train is in the next block. Yellow is line must be clear for one block and one overlap. And double yellow is line must be clear for two block and one overlap. And green is line must be clear for three block and one overlap. These are the results which has been extracted for different component, which is for the percentage of failure in different levels. Means at panel level there are only 2.57% of failure. At cable level there it is for automatic block signaling. So at cable level there is 0%. Relay micro lock 0.43% of failure is there. Point with machine 32.76% failure is there. Track circuit 46.25% failure is there. बैक इंडिकेशन 0.43, सिग्नल 13.92, पावर सप्लाई 0.21, एलसी गेट 3.43 एंड ब्लॉक इंस्ट्रूमेंट 0%. So the summary of this work, the operational safety and reliability except of four type of signaling scheme are described and their relative applicability and reliability merits and demerits are compared with respect to several factors. It is found from the analysis of the signaling system that three components, point and point machine, track circuit and signal contribute 93% of total failure cases. Under this work, this paper has been communicated in Scopus Index Journal. The conclusion is for chapter one provides the conclusion of chapter one is provides an introduction to the research work carried out in this study. The chapter discusses the need of conducting a research study in the domain of CBTC research. Objective and its scope are formulated in this chapter. Chapter 2 deals with the study of review of literature of CBTC system and its application in railway engineering. It is evident from area is still infantile, and the one possible reason for this might be complex and dynamic, and the demand for better and improved technique to deal such problem in increasing day by day. In Chapter 3, the packet drop during handover has been studied. The analytical result obtained on the rate of packet drop during handover are found to be consistent with the existing results, and the communication and train control issue and the impact of random packet drop on the stability of performances of CBTC system have been analyzed. Formulation of packet drop rate and its relation with the handover has been done, and the packet drop during handover over the wireless network has been analyzed. The simulation result shows that the rate of packet drop during handover are found to be consistent and more appropriate than the existing work under three velocity conditions. So chapter 4 focused to develop CBTC system by introducing the four-way handshake, request to send and clear to send delay model. In addition to this, the hidden station problem was also addressed. Performance of CBTC system is also analyzed in terms of saturation throughput and average delay over wide spectrum of both DCF mechanism. Chapter 5 focused on operational safety and reliability except of four type of signaling scheme, and their relative applicability and reliability merits and demerits are compared with respect to several factors. It is found from the analysis of the signaling system that three components, point and point machine, track circuit and signal contribute 93% of total failure cases. These are the references which has been used in this, in the entire work. Thank you sir for listening.
Vivek sir, I have seen the file and there were no any such comments from the expert.
Okay.
If you want to ask something, sir, it is open to you.
Yeah.
You have to experts, sir.
Yeah, I have some questions. Yeah. Bhupendra, can you explain that what are the concern with the latency and how CBTC signaling reduces the latency?
Sir, when train is moving out of the range of one access point, so it tries to connect the different one. Mean the other access point which is in the coverage area of that particular train. So this takes a few hundred millisecond, and which causing the interruption in the train to track side communication. So in CBTC, with the growth of 802.11, it reduces the MAC layer handoff latency. In CBTC, it is required that while roaming, the handoff latency must be less than 50 milliseconds. So it ensures that WLAN 802.11 ensures that the latency will be less than 50 milliseconds, and it give the uninterrupted trend to track side communication for the system.
Okay, and why you use WLAN protocol in your simulation? Why not others?
As I told that only WLAN give the and shows that in CBTC while roaming the it ensures the 50 millisecond means the delay will be 50 millisecond below the 50 millisecond. Other techniques may give the larger delay to that handoff delay to the system, which may occur the secure, which may affect the security as well as the service availability of the system.
So have you tried any other protocol?
Sir, radio, I have studies for the radio, but there were many glitches in that, and the modeling which are available existing for the existing system are very less for the radio system because of its variety of frequencies and interference in the frequency with the running network. So the radio network has not been used in such a work which I have gone through, and that is why I have also taken the same WLAN technology 802.11 for that.
Okay, and how the data transmission in RTS CTS mechanism has addressed?
Sir, this is the 802.11 MAC protocol. Under MAC protocol, there are two mechanisms, DCF and DCF mechanism is there. Under DCF, there are two mechanisms, TWS, two-way handshake, and four-way handshake mechanism. So I have analyzed the result for both the mechanism and compared the both. So under the simulation, I have found that the four-way mechanism is better to better for the CBTC system in compare with the TWS mechanism.
Okay, and I understand you are working in this area from the last 3 years.
Yes.
Say 3 or 4 years.
Yes.
And a lot of work has been carried out in a railway traction system during this tenure.
Yes, sir.
So how do you rate your works in the real life application or the real life challenges? What are the added benefit in your work? Is there any something limitations in your area? So can you comment on that?
So there are some implementation challenges are there. I have gone through these challenges also. So maintaining the communication link between the train and track side equipments is the one of challenge. Cost of replacement of older system, maintainability of new due to component and knowledge of obsolescence is the challenge. Safety improvement, continuous speed control, passenger capacity increase, quality of service, operation cost, operation running cost of the system. And these are some challenges which have been carried out throughout the study. So this is it, sir.
So are you going to discuss with these challenges your outcome with any metro system or some railway system?
Yes, sir, I have gone through the metro system, but they are very particular with their system. But will be I go through some experts and collected data from means not the actual data I got from there, but I got some information from there that this is the failure data is very important. Means the successful data is quite important, but the failure data is very important for the further research. So I've gone through many of the experts of maintaining the running of that CBTC system, that is Magenta Line in that Noida.
Okay, actually doing work is entirely different. While if something is being used, then it will be real output come of your work.
In the future, I'll definitely work. I'll regularly work on this field, and in future there is a you can say some features must be added in that because it this. Conventional this time which CBTC system are using this is the one track system only, so the tracking the multiple track system must be adopted, and that will be adopted by the metro system also and railway system also. So that CBDC system can be applied in the Indian Railway only when the multiple track system or multiple track profile will come in this. So the work, very large area of work will be there to do in this multiple track system, because this work is only for one track system. Till now, the work is only on the one track system.
Okay. How many publication in total you have from the thesis?
Sir, I have three conference publication in Scopus and one Scopus General, and one communicated in Scopus.
So it means no update after submission so far till date. It was it was there in the thesis only.
Yes.
So as a concluding remarks, if I would say how you will rate yourself your thesis work on the scale of 1 to 10, 1 is the poor and 10 is the excellent.
So I rate 8.
Okay. Thank you.
Upinder, you already spent 7 years.
Yes, sir.
Sir, 7 years.
Sir,
you read it correctly.
Sir, 7, sir.
Yeah.
You have spent 7 years, and in 7 years, the quality and quantity, just try to find out the work done. Just think.
Yes,
you must
sir.
Have done M.Tech, and you must have, you are doing PhD, and
yes, sir. Yes, I'll definitely think so.
Because I think there was a lot of options or opportunity. You can include a lot of real time issues in your work.
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir. I'll follow through your suggestions.
Yeah. Okay, ma'am. Anita, I have done from my side.
Yes, sir. Meanwhile, I will send you all the reports. Within 1 or 2 hours after just completing these presentations.
Okay.
Report, sir. Surely.
Fine. Okay. Thank you.
And Bhupender,
thank you.
At the end of the research, it is actually the starting of the research.
Yes, ma'am. Exactly.
You have completed your degree.
In our-